If they made a show called White Mirror that was about all the positive aspects of the human/technology relationship, what would be the plot of certain episodes? I read something a little while back about an AI escaping its lab and living on the internet, and subtly manipulating things for the better as it learns about humanity. I would really like to see that idea expanded on. Reminds me of some of Asimov's work. There's one where the world is basically run by two or three enormous megacomputers that organize all the goods, services, and labor. There was a part where they're asking it if people were to lie about how much stuff they're producing in a region, or manipulating the numbers to help themselves out. The computer basically says that they all already do that, but that the machine just compensates on the front end so that when people lie, they still end up producing the computer's desired outcome. Fed up with apps like Snapchat and Instagram showing you what you're missing out on, a young girl creates an app which shows all the good memories you don't remember. Mental health problems in the nation diminish significantly as a result. The young girl grows up. Gets Alzheimer's. Her relationship with her son is strained. The condition gets worse. She decides to get euthanized because her life is so miserable. The son modifies the app to connect directly with the mother's brain. Dozens of people come to visit, it's all the people her original app has helped. In addition to reliving her own memories, the people share highlights of their own. The mother dies happy, reminded she led a good life and helped so many people. Disease and aging are eliminated by science. The earth becomes a giant nursery. Once people reach a certain level of maturity, they are sent to forge their destiny among the stars. The episode would be about the person left on Earth the longest, and their journey to discover why. That's a cool idea. Thanks. The more I thought about it, the more I wanted to see it on screen. I hope that Charlie Brooker browses Reddit. A lonely person finds a not horrible group of people with similar interests and eventually meets up with some of them in real life. A lonely person codes a virtual reality based on his favorite comics and codes copies of his co-workers through DNA samples to incur his wrath engendered by his maltreatment in the office. Wait. I think my favorite detail of that episode is that almost all the mistreatment is only happening in Daly's head. Except, of course, for the CEO, who apologizes at the end of the episode for taking advantage of his hard work. Even the introductions of the other characters are done from Daly's point of view, but later revelations reframe what happened. 1. The bitchy receptionist turns out to not really talk to anyone, not just him. 2. The guy that won't get him a coffee wasn't trying to avoid Daly, he probably just felt awkward that Daly, the CTO, was asking him, an intern, to get coffee, even if the intern was already up getting coffee for his friends. Plus, he probably just got distracted and assumed Daly would be fine walking the 30 feet to get it himself. 3. The guy with the gym bag immediately apologizes and moves the bag so no one else will trip. His biggest crime is being smarmy. You also have no reason to believe the joke they laugh at after Daly leaves was directed at Daly. 4. The other developer seems to be genuinely nice, be good at his job, and to enjoy working with Daly. The miscommunication about the delayed patch was 100% Daly's fault. I don't even recall Daly's reason for trapping him. 5. The woman who we first see being two-faced on the phone turns out to have been perfectly right to call Daly out for being a creep, and warn the new girl away from him. 6. The new girl does nothing wrong other than attracting Daly's attention by admitting she's a fan of his work. So, other than the CEO walking all over him, you never actually see anyone provoke Daly in the real world in any way. Daly just sees the world that way because he's an ego-tripping asshat. Remember that episode of Futurama where Fry gets to go back and see his mom in her dream? That would definitely be the plot of one. Or the one with the professor and his parents. Jesus, those writers really had some unfinished business with their parents. Everyone has unfinished business with their parents. That's why it's always important to appreciate them when they're there. A daughter grows up video chatting with their dad who rambles on and barely lets her get a word in edgewise, giving loving advice and accolades and familial anecdotes, but who is absent at every major life event up to marriage and always apologizes. She is accompanied to the altar by her mother. Afterwards, the chat with dad has him in tears because he regrets more than anything missing walking her down the aisle because he passed away while mom was pregnant. When I was in high school, our English class had a term focused on sci-fi with the final assignment was writing your own short story. Short version, a man travels into the future but becomes trapped. Having a pregnant wife at home, he needs to figure out the math to travel back in time, but it will take years to solve. He receives an archive of videos from his wife, starting with her sending him I miss you messages, but after the birth of his daughter it becomes a chronicle of her life. Birth, childhood, school, adulthood, marriage, children, and eventually death. He watches his daughter's entire life and it motivates him to get home. It ends with the time traveler, now an old man, traveling back in time but his body can't handle the trip. Sad ending, he dies with a letter to his family apologizing for being there but thanking them for sharing it with him. I failed that assignment because it passed the word limit and probably wasn't very good. The /r/ legal advice post where users essentially saved someone who was slowly dying from carbon monoxide poisoning. That was amazing. Also, the dude who found out he had prostate cancer because he jokingly took a pregnancy test. Let's not forget the heartwarming tale of the guy who discovered his girlfriend had diabetes after he tasted her pee. There was also the one on /relationships from the new mother who was feeling frustrated and exhausted by her husband's apparent incompetence as a father. She was getting to the point where she was thinking about leaving him when users encouraged her to take him to the hospital instead. Turns out he had a brain tumor and it was affecting his cognitive abilities. Edit, here are some links for y'all. It was a little tricky to find because it's old and the originals have been deleted, but since this is a particularly interesting saga, I went ahead and I managed to rustle up some cache files for you. There was a similar one I remember. Might have also been on relationships or something similar. Girl felt like she was going crazy, got clumsy, forgot people saying things, or remembered people doing or saying things they never did. Reddit told her to go to the hospital, and once again, brain tumor. A bedridden grandmother in the hospital is able to virtually attend her grandkids' birthday parties and play with them every day. My mother actually had a friend that we barely knew, but we accepted her Facebook friend request out of courtesy, and she absolutely gushes about seeing photos of our kids on Facebook. She sends them presents and cards, she knows what they like, we've even started having Facebook calls with her. She's so warm and giving and gives them 100% of her attention, which is something parents just can't do as often as kids would like. They'll go running around the room holding the phone up to different things saying stuff like "Ruth, it snowed. Look. My wife got nervous yesterday because they took the phone outside to play in the snow and were having so much fun throwing snowballs at the phone. I told her screw it, if they break the phone doing something like that I'll buy a new one. It's worth it. She's like part of our family, and it's all because technology initially allowed her to passively participate with us. The relationship grew organically over time the way relationships used to before the internet. You'd see people frequently at work or at the store or in your neighborhood, over time have longer conversations, and ultimately grow to be friends. The same thing happened here. It started with a like or a comment here or there, then a couple messages, then a virtual birthday card. It enables people to remain in communication with so many more people passively when used correctly. Our kids have never even met her physically, though. Her immune system is too delicate to accept visitors. But even through a six screen, it's like she's really here. I can only imagine what it will be like when virtual reality lets them really be together. My mother was able to attend the birth of my son, her first grandchild, because of FaceTime. She was in the hospital, a diff one than the one I was giving birth at, recovering from a brain surgery and wasn't released in time to be there in person. I still have the video of me talking to my mother while my son is born. I did it, mommy. And they said his hair is blondish. It's a very special memory for me that she was able to be there in that moment, albeit not physically. When my grandmother died, I was on my phone the entire funeral, all the way from the funeral home, the church, and to the graveyard. I had an uncle who thought it was so rude of me, and complained to other family members about it behind my back. Then he talked to my aunt who lives in Germany, we're in the US. He found out the reason I was on my phone the whole time was because I was running a Skype video call with that German aunt. I tried not to be too obvious about having a phone, but I made sure she saw everything, the whole church service, the eulogies. She even drove with us a bit in the car on the way to the graveyard. I treated her like she was a real person there with us. When everybody greeted each other in church, I made sure to turn the camera around and say to her, "Peace be with you." When we had ice cream at the graveside asterisk, I offered her a scoop. She was so incredibly grateful to me. She couldn't afford to fly over to the US last minute to attend her mother's funeral, but I not only let her see everything, I made her feel like she was really there among family and friends. My uncle came to me to apologize. He just had to tell me how much what I did meant to her. It made him think differently about young people and their phones. Asterisk, my grandfather died 10 or 20 years before my grandmother, and a different aunt would take her to the gravesite every week. There was a carvel on the way to the cemetery, and every time they passed it my grandmother would joke that they should get ice cream at her funeral. So we did. Carvel told us it was the first time they'd ever catered a funeral before. I think they gave us a discount. A small village in Africa, where America's digital waste is sent for processing, is home to a young woman who uses the scrap to build power generators, refrigerators, autoclaves, and ultrasonic cleaners for local medical clinics. The NSA agent tracking someone's communication finds someone suffering and helps them out with money anonymously. Jazz musician living in New Orleans nearly drowns during Hurricane Katrina. He survives, but he suffers a horrible ear infection from the toxic flood waters, which subsequently causes him to go deaf. Without music, the man falls into a great bout of depression and can hardly cope with life anymore. After nearly a decade of hopelessness and despair, the man drives to a nearby bridge with plans to jump and end it once and for all. On the way to the bridge, he gets a flat tire. A good Samaritan stops and assists him with changing it. Turns out the good Samaritan knows sign language. The two talk for a while and the good Samaritan invites him to the lab he works at, where him and a team of engineers are working on designing the first pair of bone conduction headphones. Using the musician as a test subject, they successfully perfect the headphones, and the musician hears the sweet sound of jazz for the first time in 10 years. His depression fades away, and the man becomes happier than he was before the incident. And if the happy ending doesn't work, then maybe he gets hit by a bus or something. The episode should be completely silent for most of it, but right at the end when he gets his hearing back, you hear some amazing jazz. The episode ends with the musician smiling with tears in his eyes. Turns out the good Samaritan isn't designing some state-of-the-art headphones. Actually, he's designing a revolutionary virtual reality technology. Everything is a simulation. The jazz guy is actually sleeping in a lab dreaming about getting his hearing ability back. His dreams become more and more strange and insane. Finally, he learns the truth. The final scene is the jazz guy running while yelling technical support. Good vibrations music playing. Most episodes of Star Trek, The Next Generation. Someone uses an app to get food delivered to them and they get a little bit more food than they ordered. Used to order from a local diner back when I ordered out more. If I ordered dinner closer to closing time, but not close enough to be an asshole, they would usually throw in a few unsold donuts from that day for free. They were awesome. There's a pizza place near me that it's more or less an open secret, if you order close to closing time and go in to pick it up, they'll let you take an extra slice or two of whatever they have left. It's one of those places where they make a bunch of different pizzas and you can go in and just pick up a slice. A few weeks ago I ordered a pizza for a party and I realized it was almost closing time, so I figured I'd just go pick it up for the extra slice or two. It's only like a 10-minute walk from my house. Well, it was also like 10 degrees that day and must have been pretty dead, so when I go in to pick it up maybe 15 minutes before they close, they still have like a half dozen pizzas left. I was the only customer in the store and they ended up giving me two whole pizzas for free. And these aren't some tiny pizzas, they're like 16x16, 8 slices, and I can barely finish two if I tried. Great way to get repeat business. A teenager in Vietnam is killed by a landmine and his parents decide to donate his organs. One of the receivers of his organs learns about the donor just before they go to college. Years later, the receiver has completed the invention of technology that will quickly and effectively locate buried landmines. In Mozambique, they've started using mine detection rats. They're too light to accidentally set off a mine, yield less false positives than metal detectors, can be trained in 9 months, and can change handlers. Here's the full article. Editor's note, the link to the full article will be in the description, winky face. A couple years back, my brother adopted a rat in my name for birthday from Apopo. They had a little card I could look up and see how many landmines your rat had found. It was kind of a strange gift and definitely unexpected, but it is a cool idea. If I remember correctly, my brother named the rat Leroy Jenkins, seems fitting for something literally running into a minefield. Set in a post-apocalyptic wasteland, the story of a woman who breaks into a warehouse searching for a teddy bear to cheer up her terminally ill little sister. As she is searching, she encounters robot guard dogs that, upon detecting the intruder, embark on helping her find the correct row and shipping pallet on which the box of teddy bears are stored, and then merge to form a Voltron-like mega robot dog and ride her back to her sister just in time for them to perform life-saving surgery to remove the little girl's tumor and then stay with the girl as her loyal and loving robo-pets, and everyone lives happily ever after. I watched that episode yesterday and that was probably the most tension I felt in a long time. Skyping my grandma. Hi Gavin. To clarify, this is a Rooster Teeth reference.